ॐ सहनावतु सहनौघ्नक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः. The discovery of helplessness is the precursor to Viveka, Shraddha, Bhakti, everything. And the discovery of helplessness, we said, is a place of strength, not of, it's a vulnerability, but it's a place of strength because it's a place of possibilities. It's the juncture between I am in charge and oh, I am totally helpless. That juncture is a place of possibilities, because either of those continuums we are not trying to say. We are trying to see the juncture between those two places and see that as a place of possibility. And precisely because that place has to be kept emptied of one's own way of trying, one's own ministrations here. That is why it is said that Viveka is recognizing that and then being proactive, not sitting and stewing in that helplessness. That why, you know, degenerates into why me? That's not what we are talking about. That is sitting and stewing in the helplessness. But here Viveka means being an agent, a proactive agent, of being able to discern what is it that I want and how am I going to get it. Finally, some correct decisions are made because I am being proactive on my own, you know, helping myself. This is the best kind of self-help, Viveka. What do I want? I'm reasoning with myself. And what am I getting? What do I immediately want? What do I want in the long term? What am I getting into trouble? Okay, so what should I do? And this desire for help is a shubha ichha. The desire for a teacher is what is called shubhechha, an auspicious desire. It cannot be binding because the teacher doesn't bind. What binds are one's own notions, which the teacher's teaching releases one from. So how can it be binding? So this is not a binding desire. Desire for knowledge is the final frontier of all desires, where all the desires have been cooked and simmered into one desire, which I can gain, in which there is nothing more to gain. And that desire being myself is already gained, and therefore I have to know. So you see, from action, I move towards knowledge, because I understand the problem is not with doing things properly, because I'm doing everything properly, still the neighbor is getting the promotion, you know. Why? Because perhaps the promotion is not what I want, you know. What do I want? Nobody wants promotion for the sake of promotion. No, but it's more money. How much more money? You know, they'll just say, okay, $10 more per hour you'll get. That's all. Oh, but that's a lot. Yeah, but that's not why people go for promotion. Why do people go for promotion? Ha! Me? I'm the head of the department. I'm the head of this unit. I'm the head. You're the tail. I'm the head. It's for that feeling of accomplishment, the feeling of satisfaction centered on the I. A feeling that is but fleeting. 2 days into the promotion, oh my God, the workload has increased and oh, tension and oh, when will I get my pension? This is the feeling. This is the feeling. 2 days even one cannot be present to enjoy the promotion, because immediately one goes into a whole set of notions about the promotion. Yeah. This itself shows me, this kind of a reasoning shows me that what I want is not promotion. You know, what it gives me, that's what I want. And what does it give me? A sense of accomplishment
a sense of approval, a sense of satisfaction, all of which are centered on the I, a contentment. That's what it gives me. Same thing with money. Nobody wants money for the sake of money. You know, there's hundreds of thousand dollars in offshore banks. Suddenly the face becomes broad smile. Why? Because, you know, you don't even see that money. Once you give it to the bank, you don't even see the money. In fact, nowadays you don't see money at all. Because check comes and then check goes. You just have to have Shraddha that that money belongs to you and that money is there in the bank. That's what it is. And the bank is quote unquote too big to fail. These days we have to use these kinds of terms. You have to bank on the bank, and that banking on the bank is your own Shraddha. You may not have Shraddha in the knowledge and the teaching, but you have Shraddha in the bank. Bank of America. You have Shraddha. Why? Well, because thinking about that money sitting there, but it's not doing anything. No, we don't want it to do anything. We just want it to sit there and we want it to grow. We'll just keep putting it miracle grow. So we shift it between accounts. And then what happens? Then I feel secure. Even thinking about the money that's never seen. If somebody went to the bank and I said, I want to just look at all the money that I have, just bring out the cash and then take it back in, they will say, they will just quietly phone your therapist. That's what, in a friendly city like Eugene. They won't hand you to the authorities and they will not classify you as a miscreant. They will just quietly, because they know you from a long time. The therapist also banks there, by the way. Will quietly do you a favor and call the therapist, please take this fellow away. Yeah, this money you don't even see, but the thought of it, the Shraddha, it's all, you know, Shraddham, Shraddhaya Bhavam, you know, it's born of, Shraddha, born through Shraddha, and you just believe it is there. You have no reason to disbelieve that it is not there, and the thought of that money. And the looking into the bank account, in also again, not in the form of money, just some figures on your computer screen. Says, ooh, I'm doing so well. Wah. And then, what happens to that wah? Next day, all the stocks tank, everything collapses. And then, oh, oh, what happened? Why me? This is what. And the grandchild will come and say, I'm studying Newton, what goes up must come down. To try to make you feel better. This is what the whole thing is. So the Viveka is seeing that, you know, one time, ek bar, do bar, teen bar, three times, four times, trihi, dvihi, you know, second time, third time. Seeing time after time, I'm on a false lead. I keep going to the dead end. I mean, it's not that I want money. I want to feel satisfied, secure and happy. It's not that I want, you know, seven marriages. You know, all through the seven marriages, the vows have remained the same. Forever. I want the forever. When do I want the forever? Day after tomorrow in heaven? No, right now. Right here. That's why I bought that book, Be Here Now. You know, that's what I want. That's what I want most of all. So this Shubha Ichha floats on to the top like even cream on top of the milk. It floats. Even though it's heavy, it floats. Yeah, that's the beauty of it. It floats, it rises above all the other small, useless, silly ichchas. This one rises up. That's why it's called Shubha Ichha. And then what? What do you do with the cream? You know? Don't make ghee out of it and start putting in yajna again. No, that's not the point. It's a metaphorical cream of the best of the ichhas, the milk, the out of the milk, the best thing is the cream. So this is the best of the ichhas. In this, you know, this samsarabdhi, in this ocean of samsara, kshirabdhi, in this milky ocean of samsara, murky ocean of samsara, this desire rises to the top. Capitalize on it. Yes. Capitalize on it. Seek, this is what the mantra is saying. Seek a teacher. Understand that you don't know, and understand, perhaps at least give it the benefit of doubt. Here is where Shraddha is coming, that perhaps the problem is not centered on not having money, not having friends, not having a partner, not having this, not having that. But the problem is not knowing what I really want. And the problem is not knowing that perhaps all these are centered on me, and I don't know the me that I need to know. Perhaps it's not an action-oriented life. Perhaps it's a knowledge-oriented life. I have to change my orientation by seeking a guru from the Orient. That's really what it is. That's what the whole thing is. And this also brings in vairagya, viveka. Never again, just like Shraddha Bhakti are twins, viveka has a identical twin. Shraddha Bhakti are sisters, and viveka and the twin are brothers. What is the twin? Vairagya. That is it. Those are brothers. Identical twins there, identical twins here. And what does Vairagya say? Vairagya says, well, if you have understood through my brother that wherever you are headed is a dead end, and what you really want is teacher, is to set the head in order that keeps heading in the wrong direction. You want a teacher, you want to know the truth of yourself, you are convinced that the action is leading to more entanglement rather than freedom, and what you want is freedom. You're convinced of this, are you not? Yes, I am. And Vairagya says, why are you continuing to do things that are binding to you? Drop those pursuits, because in keeping with this understanding, certain actions are cleaned up. Drop those pursuits that lead you to nowhere. Drop those useless dead-end pursuits. I mean, if you take the metaphor of driving, you're driving around in circles. And thanks to, you know, Bhagavan's grace, that becomes apparent to you. That, you know, it's like in driving in DC, or just going around that 495 around, that beltway. It's a nice big circle, takes hours, you know, especially in traffic, to complete. Then you say, oh, the same exit came, another same exit is coming, third exit again and again is coming. And then what do you have to do? You have to get off this road, correct? Simple. So driving on the motoring down on the samsara highway, I have to take an exit. Veda point, not Vista point. Vedanta point. It points to Vedanta. So you take that exit. You have to take that exit. And even in which exit to take is important. Because sometimes you take the exit and it goes into another figure eight, and then there is another highway waiting to go round and round. So therefore I take the correct exit that takes me out of this samsara motorway, and then puts me on the right road, on the right royal road to moksha. That's what it is, which is myself. So that ability to get off this motoring down the wrong highway is called Vairagya. Dropping those pursuits that are not really in line with what I want, and keeping those pursuits alive that are in line with what I want. That alignment is objectivity, vairagya. So these are the four things that are highlighted in this mantra. And now let us look at the mantra and see what we can see out of that. Pariksha. Iksha means to look. Pari means all around, very thoroughly. Giving a thorough look, parikshya, having given a thorough look. To what? Loka. Yeah. Lokyate anena, through this something is reached. Loka here is a pun. It doesn't just mean all the seven lokas here, seven not so nice lokas, and this loka, that loka, metaphorical loka in the form of some pursuit or the other. But it also means those things, it's not actually heaven, etc., but also those pursuits that I think are going to lead me to where I want to go. That is what is loka. This is loka. What is this loka? Any pursuit. Because the pursuit is a doorway, correct? Yeah. It leads you somewhere. Even if the doorway is a dead end, so you open the door and there is a wall sometimes. But still you think it's going somewhere, so therefore it becomes loka. So, parikshya, having examined that all doors lead to walls. Yeah. That is the pariksha. What's behind door number 3? Another wall. What's behind door number 53? One more wall. What is behind door number 103? One more wall. Wall, 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 wall. Meaning, it's not, wall is good to break one's head against, but it's not good for anything else. No, but I can dismantle the wall, how? Yeah. This fellow said, I'm in charge, I'm going to dismantle this wall. And got a wrecking ball to dismantle the wall. And to his dismay, behind the wall was another wall. This is samsara. Yeah. This is what samsara is. So, seeing the wall behind every door, even though the door glitters, golden doorknob, some little stickers on the door, some nice, oh, come in right now, you know, have free chai, all these things are there on the door. Two for one, two walls for one, two dead ends for the price of one. All these things. Come, 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 come one, come all you can eat. Another big wall, you know, they mean bricks, yeah. And all these things are just walls because they are preventing me from really getting to the root and the heart of the matter of what is it that I really want. Why am I having dead ends wherever I go? Why am I using the relative to get the infinite and then being disappointed repeatedly? What is it that I am doing? This is all what is called pariksha. And seeing the limitations, I mean, as far as our text is concerned, pariksha includes, is up to, seeing the limitations of what? Of aparavidya vishaya. What is aparavidya vishaya? Yeah, what is para? What is apara?
The knowledge of the finite.
The knowledge of the finite, which is infinite really, because there are infinite numbers of apara. Knowledge of names and forms, those branches of knowledge that keep branching out incessantly and leave me hanging out on a limb, to use the same thing, same metaphor. I'm out on a limb because I followed too many branches. Now I don't know how to get down. The guru is the fire department. Yeah. That's what it is. I have to call for rescue because I'm stuck in this limb. This is what happens. And so therefore, pariksha loka. This pariksha is done of all the lokas. Each and every loka. How to go to Brahma loka? No, that's not the loka. Local lokas. That's why it's called loka, because it comes from local.
And if you keep going after lokas, what happens? Loko. That's all. That's what it is. Yeah. Loko. And then this is what is the end. I should see this. I should see the finiteness of pursuing infinitely finite ends in life. I should see the futility of pursuing infinitely instead of pursuing the infinite. Pursuing the finite infinitely instead of pursuing the infinite one time. I should see the difference and know where to place the value. And after pariksha of all the aparavidya vishaya, and how is this pariksha done? You know, what scope do I need? Stethoscope to find out how much samsara fever I have? What are the scopes of this pariksha? Or is this pariksha beyond my scope? No, it is within my scope. What are the scopes? What are the ways of doing this pariksha? How do I do this pariksha? How do I examine? Hello? Yeah, this is not a rhetorical question. I'm expecting an answer. How do you examine?
With the senses.
Yes, with the senses. What? What kind of senses? The senses that drive one senseless? Through seeing. Through listening, through hearing, with the pratyaksha pramanas. I examine. What else? What else? What other means of knowledge do you have? At your behest. What else is there? Anumana. Inference. Arthapatti, more than one step inference. So I see. I see means I observe with the help of my senses. I think I have a deja vu. I think I'm here. I was here before. And what happened last time? A big headache. What is happening right now? Another headache. This is how the observation keeps taking place of repeated mishaps. Yes. Mishap, Mr. Hap, all of them are taken into account. This pariksha is very important. This is taking an introspective look at one's life to see that I'm really going around in circles. No, but I have a nice life. What is nice about it? Well, you know, there are of course aches and pains. That's okay. But then, you know, I have a nice life. I'm enjoying my life. I'm having a good time. There's really nothing wrong. And don't come to the class tomorrow, starting tomorrow. And this is not for you. That's all. No, now that you mention it. Yeah. This is what the whole thing is. This is called being in denial. And if you are in denial, the Vedanta is not trying to bring you out of denial. Be in denial, happily. Because, you know, we just let people enjoy whatever they can. And if you're enjoying it, less work for the Upanishad. If you're already enjoying life, that's the whole point of life, is to enjoy it. If you're already enjoying life without Vedanta, you're not enjoined to study Vedanta. Ooh, I'm free. Yes, you're free. Pun intended. That's all it is. So that means what? The Viveka has yet to come. If somebody says that everything is all wonderful with my life, that means that Viveka is yet to come. Or they are unable to see the gnawing ravines of, you know, what is that? Fear, sorrow, pain, disillusionment, disenchantment, and then the sea of expectations flowing inside this ravine. And all kinds of problems, alligators of doubt and despair, one is not in touch with. And if you are not in touch with that, this will not, Spuranam will not take place. Spuranam, yeah. And Spurati, you know, Spurati means activation, yeah, will not take place. One will be sitting there like a dough without yeast. Yeah, it will not rise. It will not, no transformation will take place. It will all be flat, good enough for making flat chapatis. That's all. That's all it is. So therefore, this is something which is, in order for this teaching to speak to me, I've had to have some inner transformation. And this Upanishad herself has talked about the limitations of karma. That is why we had all this time seeing how the yajna ends in tears. Why? Because you're sitting too close to the smoke. Yeah. Every yajna ends in a puddle of tears because coughing, hacking by the end of it. Yeah. It is good for the community and everything. But for a Vedanta person, you evolve beyond that. You evolve beyond that. That is your strength. And so therefore what? This is the whole beauty of it. This is how to do the pariksha. How to do the pariksha also is understood in the word pari plus ikshanam. Iksha to see. That's how the pratyaksha pramanas are involved. And other means of knowledge that I have at hand are involved. Anumana is involved. If I do this, this is where it's going to go. Why? Because that's what happened last time. Yeah. When I do this, I have an extra overdose of samsara. This is the two things observed, connected together, anumana. Both includes also arthapati. Then upama. Yadyatha iha karmachito loka kshiyate tat tatha amutra pundachito loka kshiyate. Upama. How do I use upama to do this pariksha? I have a good breakfast of upma. No, not like that. How do I use upama to do this examination? What is upama first of all? Show some signs of life. What is happening? There is nothing, no spuranam is taking place. Yeah. Huh? Upama is two-step inference? What is upama? Huh? Meditation? No. It's not meditation, it's not breakfast, it is not a two-step inference. What is it? Oh, that. Upama is similarity. Is a means of knowledge that functions because of the law of similarities. And what is that? Like a donkey, a zebra is nothing but a donkey with stripes, black and white stripes. This is upama, correct? This is helpful to come to know, because when I see a donkey-like creature but with a lot of vibhuti stripes on it, then I know that I am not looking at a donkey. What am I looking at? Zebra. This is upama. This is a means of knowledge. What is the word for meditation? Upasana? How do you pronounce? Upasana. Upasana. Yeah. Upasana. And what is the breakfast? Upama. That's different. Yeah. It's not, don't get confused between upama and upasana and all these things. So, how do you apply upama here to do this pariksha? How? I told you what upama is now, right? Yeah.
Seeing,
yeah. And also seeing that this loka, even better, seeing this loka is going to just be like another loka elsewhere. This loka I have thoroughly, you know, scanned all around. And scanning which? I gain the results of that loka too, because that loka is not going to be different than this loka. I can change the neighborhood, but I cannot, you know, get that same satisfaction that I was looking for. I can go to a bigger house, what's the use? I can go to a different town because I'm sick of this town. The second town also has the same kinds of people. I can go to a different job. These are all lokas. I can go to a different job. But that job is just like this job with a new boss in a new body, but the same old ideas. Same dictatorial and control freak tendencies. This boss is equal to that boss. This house is equal to that house. This marriage is equal to the rest of the marriages that I feel like I want. This child is equal to 10 other children. Yeah. This child is equal to just another child will be the same. How is it going to be different? It will also have two hands and two legs. You know? And also from our standpoint of the Upanishad, the contextually, this loka in terms of what? The loka that I see is also like the unseen lokas, heaven, Brahma loka, sitting on cloud nine, right next to Brahmaji, shoulder to shoulder, you know, and putting an arm around his arm. All this is also finite. This is the beauty of Upama. This is how one gets, one sees that. This is how one uses that. So therefore, this is all very important. And therefore what? Therefore this is all comes under pariksha, anupalabdhi. You know, whatever I want is not in the place where I think it is. Yeah, what is anupalabdhi? Huh? What is anupalabdhi?
What you just said?
Yes.
Yeah, well, that something is not where I think it is.
It is the cognizance of absence. Yeah, what happened? All these, how many times we have studied? Every day we are listening to this and studying this. Where did it all go? Anupalabdhi, cognizance of absence. Cognizance, meaning I see that what I want is not where I think it is. And that where is important. Where is not outside where. Where is right here, centered on the eye. That is what is important. It's neither outside nor inside. It's centered on the eye. Inside means another problem. Where inside, you know? In the toes, in the head, in the neck, where is it? So this is how all the pramanas that I have at my disposal, even though it cannot produce the knowledge which is actually unproduced, uncreated, it can help me get to dropping off the activities and help me do this exercise in Viveka that is going to place me in proximity with the teachings in a way that I can imbibe them. This is what it's going to do. And that is why this is important. This pariksha. And so the pariksha is this all-round look at all my pursuits and lokas that I am pursuing and seeing something that they have in common. What is it they have in common? The next word describes it. Karma chitan. Karma bhihi chitan. Chitan means what? Ching, jagane, to collect. Ching is not ching ching, cha ching, no. Jing. Jing is a second conjugation verb, jayane, in the sense of collecting. Parikshya lokan karma chitan. The lokas are something that are what? Karma chitan, karma bhihi chitan, collected by what? Action. The lokas are collected here means gained. Seeing that all the lokas have one thing in common. What is that one thing? They're driving me loco. Yeah. And what is that one thing they have in common? That they are finite means what? This is beautiful. This unpacks the concept of finite. This is very nice. Why is it finite? Because it is collected through action. Action being finite, the resources that I have at hand being finite, I can never produce the infinite. That's why it is finite. That's why the Upanishad uses the term for finite, karma chitan, collected through action. Every pursuit is the result of action. The results of every pursuit is the result of action. The result of going to loka in terms of this place, that place is the result of action. And everything that I have in my capacity to produce is nothing but the result of action. I have in my capacity action and result of action. That's all I have. And in fact, if you look, take a closer look at action and result of action, I don't have the action. Result of action is not in my hands. Is it in your hands? No. Bhagavan holds the copyright. That's why wrong results come. Correct results never come. That's why I keep acting. Because if in one go you could get what you want, then everybody would enjoy a retired life. Yeah, sitting and sipping tea in the garden. You know, who doesn't want to do that all day long? Everybody wants to do that. But why is, you know, one able to do that? One is not able to do that precisely because whatever one tried to do to get to that state of doing that fell by the wayside. Stocks did not cooperate. Bonds made me feel bound. And this thing did not work out. This job did not pan out. No, everything is fine, but I don't have anyone to sit and sip the tea with. That also did not pan out. Yeah. And then what? Then I thought I could do this and then retire at 62, but now I see I'll have to work till 82. First to be alive. Then we'll see. You know? Who is planning? We don't know who is planning. What is their lifespan? We don't know. So karma chitan, this is not a small thing. This is a huge thing. A very big thing. Very big thing. And what is that big thing? That big thing is knowing that I only have access to action. That is already cut in half. Not even the results of actions are accruing to me. What I deserve, I don't get. What I want, I don't get. What I wish for, I don't get. Much less what I work for, I never get. That's why neighbor is getting promotion. And in fact, there is some moving truck that is coming and the neighbor happily informs, I'm moving to my dream house. Yeah. Giving you further nightmares. Yeah, this is what it is. The only happy thing is you will be getting rid of him because he's always gloating in your face. But knowing the my karma, another fellow just like that moves in. This is what the whole thing is. This is seeing that all the lokas have something in common, that they are based on my pursuit and my action. And they peter out in the form of a small little trickle of result of action over which I have no control. No control at all. What do you mean I have no control? I have made myself a self-made man. I have earned for this. You did not work, my paycheck. And I invested wisely so that 7 generations of my family can sit and eat. I did all this. Oh, really? Yeah. I earned this money. How? Because I have a great big degree. Not only degree, I have pedigree. I come from very aristocratic family. I went to Oxford, I went to this, I went to that, because that's where all the aristocrats go. I went. How did you go? Oh, parents sent. Ah, okay. You had parents? Self-made man had parents? Yeah, they were there. They sent. But you know, they were not loving and they just abandoned me at a young age. They sent me off to boarding school. I became a boarder. And I was just you know, left alone and I did everything on my own. How did you make it through college? I was the brightest student. How were you a student? Student is a relational, you know, identity. Well, there were some professors. Aha, oh, some. Okay, good. You're getting somewhere. No, but they didn't know how to teach. They were all idiots. I poured all my work. You know, I burned the midnight oil. Oh, there was oil for you to burn. Oil was given. Professor was given. No, it was all my brains. Ah, brain was given. Table to study was given. No, but I had just a rickety table. Rickety table was given. I had only two pairs of clothes. One was hanging on the tree and the other was hanging on my body. One day I ate rice and dal. Another day I ate what?
Dal
and rice. That's how I did. Dal was there. Wow, you had a two-course meal. Rice was there. And variation was there. One day dal rice, one day khichdi. Oh, good. We're getting somewhere. Two pairs of clothes were there. Wow. Really? Well, did you go to the cotton field and catch the cotton and like Gandhiji sit and do the charkha? You know? You spun your own yarn? No, now I'm spinning the yarn. That's right. You're spinning the yarn now. Then you didn't spin the yarn. Clothes were given to you. Midnight oil was given. The brain to pursue this degree was given. The perseverance to, you know, be there at all, against all odds were given. There is behind, you know, every success, there is a whole slew of anonymous, unacknowledged factors whose name is Daivam, whose collective name is Daivam, Bhagavan. That is Bhaga, that is that auspiciousness. Unacknowledged, it goes under the rubric of self-made man. I am producing, I am doing, I. Bhagavan says, I. Go, you know. Bye-bye. That's what it is. So the self-made man, you can make the self-made man disappear. Just ask a few poignant questions. Did you sit in your lab and make your own brain and then open a hole and, you know, with a little hinge and then put it and close it back and put some sutures around? Obviously, the person has to say, no, brain was given. You have to acknowledge what is given. This is what the thing is. So, and why I'm talking about this? Because these are the ways in which the impediments come to seeing the finiteness of action and seeing also that I am not in charge of the results of action. If whatever I have done have worked out for me to make me feel more secure financially, to make me feel more secure educationally, to make me feel more secure relationally, in relation to my children or my spouse or partner, whatever it is, it's because I have been endowed with a series of great gifts. This is what it is. And those gifts which are not acknowledged go under the rubric of I. It's a recipe for disaster, a big disaster, waiting to explode. This is what it is. And so therefore, I see in common this karma chitan, karma bhihi chitan, that whose chayanam, whose collection of all these things, lokas that I have, are because of karma, because of action, and I only have a say over action. The results of action are not in my hands. That's why whatever is given, whatever effort is put, it's not coming back as much as I had put. Why? Because there are big bad impediments in the forms of wolves of karma lurking to swallow up whatever I deserve, whatever I negotiate for. Yeah, the wolf says swaha. Yeah, that's what happens. Even the ghee reserved for yajna is drunk up by the cat. You know, then what happens? Finished? Then this is what is This is what it is. Now, there is one cat in the backyard. There was in fact 5-6 orange kittens when we did a yajna here behind this house when the goddess used to be here. And these baby cats, what are they called? Kittens. So these kittens, 5-6 of them, as soon as people were putting the yajna, they would catch the hand and try to bring the spoon to their mouth. Yeah, and they were all given away. They all became fat because they had drank so much ghee, you know. And then all the leftover ghee also they drank. And one of them I named Yajna Datta, given by Yajna. He's still there. He's in the backyard. Fat, orange, surly fellow. He roams around like no one else but me. He has got Sarvatma Bhava, Ahameva Sarvamidam. His name is Yajna Datta. Anyway, so this is the thing. So this is what it is. So the karma is so volatile that even when I, you know, keep some milk for Abhisheka, that is also drunk up by the cat. The karma comes in the way. And this I don't see. That way, where did all this karma come from? They are the results of useless actions done in other lives. This I have to make the connections. This life is given to useless action. Other lives have been already gone to useless actions. Whole life after life after life after life of life. Useless, 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 purposeless, 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 purposeless. How long can I go on like this? This is what is seeing that commonality in all the aspects that I pursue, in all the objects, situations, places, things, people that I pursue have everything, the one thing in common. What are they? What is that one thing in common? One thing in common is that, what is that? What is that? It is born of my pursuits, and those pursuits are finite because they are gained in time and lost in time. All that are defined are finite because they are born of pursuits. This is what I have to understand. And who is this I who has to understand this? Brahmana. Who is this Brahmana? Brahmana Brahmani Charati. The one who desires to know Brahman is called Brahmana. The one who is qualified to know Brahman is called Brahmana. Because that qualification comes from this pratyaya, this special suffix called nini. Tachilye nini. That shila, that ability, that capacity is what is important. Brahmani charitum shilam asya asti brahmachari brahmana. Same thing, that nini feeling is that capacity to pursue Brahman, that qualification is given, it is there. And that is what is, that is who it is directed against, towards this mantra. That's why I said, you know, all the people who feel that nothing is wrong with your life, there is no need to attend the class. Yes, free. I have moksha. Yes, you have moksha from the Vedanta. This is what it is. So that's why even the Upanishad says, this is for those people who have done this introspection and who would like to continue doing with this introspection, even though they may not have done it completely. They would like to start this introspection, even that is okay. Pariksha lokan karmachitan brahmanah. The one that is ready to take a new look at their life. The one that is finally ready to acknowledge that yes, some mistakes have been made and are continuing to be made. And what is the mistake? It's a mistake on things. That's what it is. That's what is a mistake. It's a mistake. Missed opportunity. Missed, you know, obvious, the most obvious thing, which is the Atma, which is myself, which needs to be known, is missed and mistaken for something else that I end up pursuing. And a mistake because I have substituted knowledge for action. Where there should be action, there should be action. Where there should be knowledge, there should be knowledge. You cannot substitute action for knowledge for action and action for knowledge when it's not relevant. You cannot do that. You know, if something is gained by doing, you have to do. I want to taste what yogurt is like. Well, you have to buy some milk, you have to get a starter, another piece of yogurt you have to borrow from somewhere, you have to mix it and keep it in a warm place, and then 8 hours later you can have yogurt. That's where action is needed. No, but I would like to know the meaning of the word upama. What do you have to do? Go to the backyard and jump up and down. Correct? Yeah. I have to learn. I have to know. Here the action is not going to help. So I have to see. That pariksha includes that seeing the futility of action where the problem has moved because of Viveka Vairagya. The problem has taken a U-haul and a U-turn and moved to a place that is unreachable by action. It has moved to the place of knowledge, of discernment, of knowing. This switch one has to make. Who? The one who is interested in Brahman. The one who is seeing that there must be something more to what is being said here. There's something more to just the finite ends and means. There's something more I have to learn. This can benefit me. That person, only to that person it is directed. That's why it's in the singular. Because such a person is singularly worshipable. Even if you have this ichha for moksha, one becomes venerable. Because the object of the ichha, which is Bhagavan, is really not being different from the subject. The object is venerable. The pursuer is also equally respectable and venerable. Because the object is the subject. The object is not the object. That's what we are learning. And so, therefore, that's why it is in the singular, because rare are those people to whom these words which have been we've been talking about for the last 2 hours is even going to speak, much less attract. Rare are those people. They have singularly identified themselves. That's why the Shruti puts that person in the singular. It doesn't say Brahmanaha, you know? Yeah. Because Manushyanam Sahasreshu Kaschid Yatati Siddhaye Yatatam Api Siddhanam Kaschin Mam Veti Tatvataha. Out of all the people, you know, who are pursuing this, that or the other, thousands, millions, billions, teeming millions of people, one is interested in moksha. And out of the thousands of people interested in moksha, one is interested in knowledge. Out of the thousands of people interested in knowledge, one actually gains it. Rare is the person who has done this U-turn of introspection. Pariksha here is introspection. Finally coming to a resting place of the I, and with the eagerness and desire to discover this resting place as being the cause of the universe. That is what is a Brahmana. A Brahmana also means the one who is, you know, the one who has reduced ragas and dveshas. Brahmana. That is, those are all the meanings of the word. Whose antahkarna doesn't have a huge load of all kinds of nonsense. Brahmana. Brahmana also means a sattvic person thereby. One who has done a lot of work on ragadveshas, they are generally, you know, non-reactive and more compassionate than others. They're able to let go. They're able to say, all right, theek hai, no problem. So this is what is Brahmana. What does the Brahmana do? Pariksha. Pariksha of what? Lokas. What has lokas? That which drives you loko. Yeah. Lokas. What is a loka? Fields of experience, pursuits, and also other lokas, everything. Other lokas better than this, where, you know, Assam tea is served, not the regular tea. You know, this is what you have to see that. You know, this is not anything better. Like this, you have to be able to see, discern. And how is this discernment done? Using the means of knowledge that you have at your disposal, all of them. That is why Bhagavan has given you that. And seeing that none of them are going to be helpful in knowing what I want to know, because I have graduated from the realm of seeking, you know, as a doer, to realm of seeking as a knower. So the seeker is the same. Before I was a seeker through doing, the means are different. Do you see the difference? The seeker is the same. I am still a seeker. Before I was a seeker of thrills. Yeah. All kinds of thrills, you know, up and down, how to jump up and come down, and how to, you know, take a class on balancing act on the precipice. That's what you're doing in life anyway. So that's why, you know, how to balance on the precipice of a hill. All these things, rock climbing, all these dangerous sports people take for this thrill. And the thrill, and sometimes that's how they discover Shraddha, because they want to fall from a height and then discover some Shraddha. Silly. This is what it is. So seeing that all of them are deadened pursuits that leave me deadened, jaded and faded, this is what is the Brahmana. To him, to her, such a teaching applies, because they have the wherewithal to do this pariksha. They are strong. That is the examination. Now every exam has a result. Yes, no?
Yes.
What is the result of this examination? Nirvedam ayat. Ayat. Ayat means has come, gained. Gain. Gain of what? Nirveda. Oh, I thought I have to go closer to the Veda. This is saying Nirveda. Nirveda here means Vairagya, objectivity. Objectivity, ayat. May one gain objectivity, dispassion. After gaining compassion for oneself and others. May one gain dispassion towards those pursuits which are dead-end pursuits, which leave me exhausted and in a mire of confusion. Obviously, I am not going to pursue those pursuits. Then I can't just sit at home. Come to class. That's what it is we are saying. Change the pursuit from doing to knowing. Simply put, that's all it is. All this time we have been talking about. All these things that we have been talking about, you know, decocked into this alone. The doing is going to be one's undoing. The knowing the truth of oneself is going to clarify this further and see that there is really nothing for you to do to be approvable, to be healthy, you know, in terms of have healthy attitudes, to be fulfilled, to not put yourself down, to be compassionate towards yourself and others. That's already there. It has to be discovered. So therefore, the crux of my life, the focus of my life is going to change from doing to knowing. This is what I have to see. I have to see this. And the one capable of seeing this is called Brahmana. And then, it's not enough to see this. I have to stop the habitual orientation of becoming, continuing as a doer, 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 doer. Yeah. All the time, just pursuing dead-end things. This is what I have to have, a shift in my pursuit. I have to prioritize that knowledge to gain this shift in the pursuit. This is called Nirvedam Ayat. And the Shruti is kind enough to declare the results of the exam even in what is that? More striking terms. What is the result of this exam of seeing the dead end of every pursuit? Nasti akritaha kritena kritena karmana akritam brahma nasti. Through this world of works, actions, kritena karmana, through the world of action, akritam, that which is uncreated, the limitless I, which I am seeking, which is not a product of karma, is not possible, has nothing to do with karma. Seeing the truth of the I as beyond the reach of karma, seeing this ajnanam as beyond the reach of karma. Only jnanam can touch this ajnanam. I did not produce the ajnanam. I cannot produce the jnanam. And the jnanam is not a product. It is myself alone. And this knowledge of I is already free from all these insecurities, fears, and these, you know, lack of this, that, approval and judgment. This is the one that I have to interrogate. Nasti akritaha kritena. Ooh, that sounds good. Then I can sit at home and sip tea? No. What do I do now? You have to go in search of a teacher. Really? Yes. How? You have to first go collect some firewood in the shape of little question marks, twigs. And then take the twigs to the teacher. And then lay them at the feet of the teacher. This is for the teacher who is a grihastha. That is why the twigs. But the twigs, you know, taking the twigs means it's an offering. And the offering is so that one shows one's readiness to learn. One is able to do anything to learn. That is the whole idea. And that part of this we will see tomorrow. Yeah. So this weekend is the last weekend of Mundaka. Unfortunately, my schedule has undergone a big change. You are going to teach? Yeah? Okay. So, we will continue with the regular class timings, which are 7th, tomorrow I am here, yes. After that I am gone for, I don't know how many, two months? I am gone for 2 months. Mm-hmm. I am briefly back for 3-4 days in September. Yeah, Georgia will be live streamed. And I think you have the flyer, and you can do the otherwise post the flyer also on Adobe so people can come and take it and download it.
I can do that.
Huh?
I can do that.
Yeah, that will be nice.
Some people, but
yeah, so that anybody can come on Adobe, even live stream people can go on Adobe,
yeah,
and download that flyer, so that has the timings. It's on Eastern time, so you can join that in. It will be either on Adobe or live stream, whatever the Wi-Fi there permits. Just check on both. And then, so that next week there are classes, which was originally off. So that's nice.
Next weekend,
there will be class. The Monday, starting Monday, there will be class. And not this Monday, but the following Monday, 27th onwards. From 27th to 3rd August, there is class. After that, I'm leaving for about 2 months. And I'll be back, and the regular classes, all of them or some of them, we don't know, depends on your interest, your retention, your desire for these classes and your presence, you know, and I mean it in all ways. Yeah. So if whatever you bring, the classes, you know, help, that's all it is. So your sankalpa and everything, so depending on that, we may have more classes. The regular classes, however, we'll continue, and I've asked Janani to take up a text called Aparokshanubhuti, and that will be taken up 7:30 to 10 a.m. August 9th and 10th, that weekend it will begin, and then it will, and Tuesdays and Wednesdays 6 to 7, our Shvetashvatara Upanishad and Kathopanishad times. So we will have that. So tomorrow is the last day for Mundakopanishad classes for a while now, and so we will do that. And we've had a lot of classes up till here, Bhashya and all these things, and they will, you know, hopefully continue with Bhagavan's grace. When I come back, we will pick it up. So in the meantime, you can do some enjoy some reruns in the archives, and then enjoy Aparokshanubhuti, which will be taught on this, on that, or this one. It will be taught on Adobe Classroom.
Mm-hmm.
So you can just come for those, you know, four times a week. Aparokshanubhuti, very nice text, attributed to Adi Shankaracharya. It's got a very nice refrain. Sri Harim Paramanandam Upadeshtaram Ishwaram Vyapakam Sarva Bhutanam
Karanantam namamyaham. Very nice opening prayer. And so, so tomorrow there will be Mundaka Upanishad class, the final Mundaka Upanishad class. And Tuesday, Wednesday, we will have all regular schedule. After that, we will have to drop the classes for a bit because suddenly the travel has taken over. And so, this is what we will do. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om. 4 o'clock, Kathopanishad. Yeah, Bhashya.
And Vamadeva.
Okay, I'm glad it was clear. I'm glad you were.